Does the government work for us, or do we work for the government? How has the United States changed from a humble, peaceful republic into a police state? Tonight, freedom versus security. This past week, the United States Supreme Court told police that they could break down the door of your home if they smell what they think is smoke from the use of marijuana coming from inside. Last week, the Indiana Supreme Court told police in that state that they can enter a private home even if they're not looking for evidence of a crime. And yesterday, the Justice Department revealed that FBI and local police are executing sneak and peek warrants. They break into your home, seize an item, and don't tell you that they've done this for over 18 months. And they are doing this in ordinary criminal prosecutions, not just for the pursuit of terrorists, as the law requires. This is all about the slow loss of personal liberty.
The number one priority of this government and the future governments will be to protect the American people against terrorist attack.
After the events of 9/11, the Department of Justice came to us in the Congress and said, these terrorists succeeded because we in the government did not have sufficient power to have stopped them. And we therefore need the Congress to pass legislation correcting these deficiencies in previous law and giving us, the government, more power.
So just 6 weeks after the attack on the World Trade Center, Congress passed a new law called the Uniting and Strengthening America by Providing Appropriate Tools Required to Intercept and Obstruct Terrorism Act of 2001. The Patriot Act. Sure is the axis of evil for bad acronyms. The Patriot Act is an act to deter and punish terrorist acts in the United States and around the world, to enhance law enforcement investigatory tools, and for other purposes. Other purposes?
Under the USA Patriot Act, among other things, you can now have people who are tried on a military barge off the coast, a U.S. military barge off our coast or some other country. They could be tried by a military tribunal. We wouldn't know the charges against them, let alone the evidence. They could be convicted. They could be sentenced to death by this military tribunal and thrown overboard, and we wouldn't even know their names.
When the Patriot Act was first sent to the Congress by the Bush administration, it came with a request that we hold no hearings on it so that there would be no public input or public discourse.
Imagine if your family was awakened in the middle of the night by a team of federal officers. Well, that's exactly what happened to a woman and her children in Granville County.
Amanda Lamb is in the newsroom joining us now. And Amanda, we understand that because this case falls under the Patriot Act, a lot of the usual rights for defendants not available here.
That's right, David. The Patriot Act was created after 9/11. It allows federal agents to investigate suspected cases of terrorism swiftly in order to better protect our country. But one Granville County mother says it gives the federal government too much leeway. Her son was taken into federal custody 2 months ago. She can't get him out, and she can't get any answers.
According to the United States government, this 10th grader, who has never been in trouble with the law before, is now a suspected terrorist.
They said that he was being arrested for making bomb threats.
Annette Lundeby told the officers that someone stole her son's IP address and used it to make crank calls through the internet, making it look like the calls had originated from her home. She says the FBI's extensive search of her home turned up nothing.
Quietly and quickly, Congress reauthorized the Patriot Act last week, just before ducking out for the holiday weekend. The Senate passed the bill 72-23. The House followed suit just hours later, passing it 250-153. All in all, more than 80 Democrats supported the bill. We're going to bring in Jeffrey Rosen. He's a law professor at George Washington University. He's also the legal affairs editor at the New Republic. Jeffrey, thanks so much for joining us. Really appreciate it. Let me start with that fundamental question. Is there something significantly different about this Patriot Act as opposed to the one during the Bush years?
Absolutely not. In fact, the three most controversial provisions of the Patriot Act were reauthorized with barely any debate. These are the provisions that authorize roving wiretaps, the infamous Section 215, which allows the government to seize any tangible thing, data, cell phone records, what have you, merely by saying that it's relevant to a terrorism investigation. And then finally, these secret national security letters that also allow the government to seize any data. And if you receive this letter, you're not even allowed to mention it to anyone else. And investigation in 2007 found serious and widespread abuse of these letters. It found there were 140,000 of them issued between 2003 and 2005, many with people with no connection to terrorism. These are the very provisions that Harry Reid and other Democrats properly denounced during the Bush years. And this past week, as you said, with barely any debate, the same people just voted to reauthorize these terrible provisions.
Government was giving us kind of a running tally.
There have been a total of over 480 people arrested or detained. 614 persons.
Detained nearly 1,000 individuals.
He swept broadly, he swept blindly, until the number was over 1,000. And people started asking questions. They said, how many of these 1,000 people have been charged with the crimes of September 11th? And the answer was zero. Then people asked, well, how many of these people, these suspected terrorists, have been charged with any crime related to terrorism? And the answer was zero. So those were not good answers from the government's perspective. So what did the government do? In early November, it announced, we no longer will give out a daily tally. It's too difficult for us to give out a daily tally. It wasn't difficult for them when they thought it sent the message that we're doing something to fight terrorism. But when it started to send the message, we're locking up lots of people who don't have any, aren't even charged with terrorism, they just stopped telling us how many people were detained.
Most Congress members admit that they never even read it.
It is an immutable law of the universe that if you give government power, it uses it.
But in reality, our liberties have been on decline from almost the moment of the conception of this great country. The hateful Alien and Sedition Acts, which criminalized free speech that was critical of the government, were enacted in the 18th century by the same generation, indeed in some cases the same people, who adopted the First Amendment with its iconic language that Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. Those laws expired when Jefferson refused to enforce them. But two generations later, another president would argue that he could arrest state officials and newspaper editors with whom he had political differences. And two generations after that, the government enacted the Espionage Act of 1917, which made it a crime to speak out against World War I or to oppose the draft. And two generations after that, FDR arrested Japanese Americans and Italian Americans just because of their nationalities, and the Supreme Court let them get away with it. And two generations after that, the war on drugs was prosecuted to distract us from the disaster in Vietnam and the economic destruction brought about by wage and price controls and the rejection of the gold standard. Each of these assaults on freedom used the previous assault as a legal justification.
The war in Iraq may be over, but America is still fighting its so-called war on terror. U.S. President Barack Obama says he won't block a new security bill, which for the first time writes into law the indefinite detention of alleged terrorists at Guantanamo Bay, even American citizens.
It was very, very noxious, very, very reminiscent of the emergency regulations introduced in Nazi Germany in 1933. It goes way beyond the Good War Powers Act, and it's meant to intimidate people, to make sure that the people don't act up, speak out.
U.S. Congress passed a bill which repeals posse comitatus, which means that we have now institutionalized and codified martial law. Right now, the battle against terrorism involves all of us. Everybody in this country is a potential terrorist. And the words that they use in there to bring everybody in as a potential terrorist is any associated forces, which means that if you happen to visit a website, happen to attend a meeting, happen to do one association, you can be accused of being a terrorist. And the bill says you have no right to a lawyer. And this president, just about a year ago, announced that some of these bad people, even though they're American citizens, don't deserve even charges, that they can now be assassinated.
The vote was 93-7. So only seven senators object to the literal evisceration of the Fifth Amendment.
Someone missing fingers on their hands is a suspect. Someone who has guns, someone who has ammunition, someone who has more than 7 days of food in their house.
We're talking about the military arresting citizens, and then you disappear forever with no trial for no reason. And they say they can kill you if they want and torture you or have a military trial, whatever they want. I mean, this is the royal flush. This is the creme de la creme. This is the Mike Tyson in his prime of boxers, the Babe Ruth of baseball. You sit here and you look at this, and it is so mind-blowing. And it's happened. And now they're just going to slowly roll it out, and they'll use it on examples of, you know, turbaned brown people, so it'll be okay.
Radical change is immediately noticeable, not just when it is radical, but when it is disruptive. But if it happens slowly and in steps, if it happens in degrees, eventually the radical change will have happened, and we will not have noticed it at all.